CSN International presents To Every Man an Answer, the live apologetics program that equips you to give a reason for the hope that lies within you.
If you have a Bible question or a question on the Christian faith, you can call us at 1-888-827-5276. Again, that's 1-888-ASK-CSN.
Let's get things started. Here's today's host, Mike Kessler.
Hi, and welcome to Thursday's edition of To Every Man an Answer. And just once again, we get together every weekday afternoon at this time, set this hour aside for just answering questions about the Bible from the Bible, looking at current events through a biblical perspective, and even reviewing what we hear in church. Is it even in the Bible at all? So if you've got a question you'd like to ask us, that number to call again, 8888-ASK-CSN. It's toll free, and got some lines open, so you're sure to get on if you call right now. Joining me today, special guest and friend, Greg Block from Calvary Chapel in Rapid City, South Dakota. Hi and welcome.
Great to be with you again this afternoon, Pastor Mike. What a glorious day it is. Lord's given us another day to be able to serve Him and to exalt Him and to declare to the whole world we're under new management and that we love Him more than anything. What Amen. About you, Mike?
Amen.
Is it a great?
It's good. Now, you just had your Christian festival back there and some interesting praise reports.
Let me share this with you. It's called Hills Alive. It's every July here in Rapid City. So people from all over the Black Hills come and you know, Wyoming and Nebraska and Montana and North Dakota and Colorado all come up, and all kinds of Christian bands. I think King and Country was the headliner this year. But let me tell you this, Mike. Adam, one of the guys that goes to our church during the time, because he had heard, I had mentioned, I don't know, maybe 2 months, 3 months, 4 months ago, when it was a possibility that you might be coming out to be part of that and have a booth. And he said, "Hey, is Pastor Mike going to be here?" And I said, "Well, no, that didn't necessarily work out." And he said, "I got to tell you, I got saved listening to CSN." And I said, "That is so cool." And Mike, we hear so many stories about people that maybe they're you say it every day that they're a lot of people that are in good, healthy, well-balanced, Bible-believing, Bible-teaching churches might take it for granted that they've got access to that kind of solid teaching, because a lot of people don't. So they depend on the airwaves, or they depend on watching through social media to not only be fed, but when I am just a participant, when I'm just a spectator and I'm listening to you and the other guys, and I'm on the chat on Facebook, I see that a lot of people actually use that thread and kind of look at CSN as their, not necessarily as their home church, but as an additional community. And here's one more, a gal from, I think she was from Nebraska, that she had come through the tent. And she came up and said, "I just wanted to introduce myself because I listen to you. I know that you're on occasionally with Pastor Mike on To Every Man an Answer. And so I just wanted to come in and meet you and introduce myself to you and just tell you that I love To Every Man an Answer." So there's a shout out of there's people all across the country, all across the world are being impacted by the vision of To Every Man an Answer in CSN. So how about a quick plug to say that in addition to where you're normally supporting, you know, your home church, if you can add CSN to your financial support, I just encourage you to do it. It doesn't have to be a lot, but a whole bunch of people giving a lot, you know, 5, 10, 50 bucks a month, whatever it might be, that adds up, and that can add radio stations, and you'd certainly be storing up your treasures in heaven, knowing that it's going to a good, healthy, honorable support system. Amen. Okay, yeah.
Nobody's flying Learjets here. Oh, I'll tell
you. You don't have a private, Mike. You don't have a private helicopter.
No, I don't have that. You know, I just always am amazed at all this stuff. I guess John Kerry, the czar,
the greenie czar.
Somebody asked him a question about his jet or Learjet, and he goes, "I don't own a Learjet. I've never owned a Learjet." What he didn't say was that his corporation, his wife, does,
he got
busted. So again, it's really incredible. But you know, we just want to continue to get the gospel out. We know days are short. You know, Jesus said this is one of the ways you can identify that his coming is soon, because really, everyone, it's not just the United States. It's everywhere is like this. The whole world morally is rotting, and it's getting worse almost by the week now. You know, what used to take 5, 10, 15 years to make a major departure from normal life now is happening by the week, where we have these people in high-ranking places declaring war on children to change their sex. It's absolutely insane what's going on. And the attack on parents, as an example, in California with their laws that if you go against this transgender stuff, that your children can be taken away from you. You know, in other words, if you're a parent trying to protect your children, you're a bad person, you know, because the government knows more than you. Shades of Adolf Hitler all over again, right here and right in California, man. It's amazing. Yep, sure is. And again, I feel my heart goes out to all of you who love the Lord, live in California, and those that maybe are just good old boys, good old girls that look at your state. I grew up in California. I know. And I see a state now completely devoid of any moral fabric whatsoever. It's completely debased. And you see, culture is what holds your nation together. And the attack on the family, the attack on American values and all this stuff, they're attacking the very thing that holds America together. They don't care. Because remember, Nikita Khrushchev said in 1957, "We will bury you." You know, he put into plan to infiltrate the schools, the seminars, all the different political offices with communist thinking, with liberal thinking. Friends, we're here. And again, the dumbing down of America, thanks to the school systems of America, have been a complete success. Hey, drive by a school. Park your car out by a playground where the third graders are playing. Listen to the language that these kids in third grade are using. Sounds like a bunch of truck drivers. I did this. I am not making this up. And this is in the, you know, the heartland of America in Idaho. And I drove up and I came up to a stop. My windows were down. It was warm. And I listened to the kids out on the playground, and every other word was some profanity. I couldn't believe my ears. And then we had a school teacher in our church, and she said, I asked an interesting question. I just said, How many of you have your real mom and your real dad living in your house right now? Now, this is in Idaho. I think she said one or two kids put up their hand. Everybody else was from a broken home. How long can you do this? So then what raises your children? Well, the school system and the junk they see on the big screen. That's what it is. Whether it's TV or the movies, it doesn't make any difference. So yeah, America's under attack. Let your light shine, because again, I believe Jesus is coming very, very soon. Let's go to the phones. We have Daniel on the line, Connecticut. Hi, welcome.
Hello, a question and a prayer request, please. Question is, Manasseh, such in the Bible is called the half tribe of Manasseh. Would you kind of elaborate on that, how it came to be the half tribe? And
well,
how that,
how... half of it was on one side of the Jordan River, the other half was on the other side. Your thoughts, Greg?
Yeah, well, you know, that goes all the way back when God had rescued his people from being in Egypt for that 400 years, and they wander in the wilderness for another 40 because they're getting a little uptight there. And then as they're about ready to cross the Jordan River, cross west over the Jordan River into the Promised Land, into Canaan, the land flowing with milk and honey, there were several tribes that had decided that they wanted to stay on the east side of the river, and Joshua said, okay, well, we'll let you do that, but you need to go and fight so that the rest of us can take over Canaan, and then you can come back. Now those three tribes were Reuben, Gad, and Manasseh. But why it's the half tribe is because Manasseh and Ephraim were the sons of Joseph. So Ephraim went over, but Manasseh didn't. So that's why. So basically half of Joseph's lineage stayed on the west side and went to the west side and half stayed on the east side. And that would have been that's why they're known as the half tribe of Manasseh.
Yeah, and the Jordan River was just kind of a natural barrier. And so this is why they decided some to stay on one side. Most went over and crossed over the Jordan River into the Promised Land, but some there stayed on the other side. Hope that helps.
Yeah, thank you. Appreciate it. And may I get a prayer request in?
Absolutely. How may we help?
Appreciate that. Thank you. I'm in a valley with some medical stuff. One of the things that my mind is wheeling around is between some of the anxiety and kind of the depressive waves that come in and out. I'm concerned about, offending God, and grieving the Holy Spirit when I dip into these things and stuff like that. And like the last thing I want to do is, affect my relationship with God. I know he loves me and I know all that, but I feel sometimes when I get into these depressive ways that, God hasn't given us a spirit of fear. And I feel when I go there that, it's like, oh, no, I don't want to offend him. And, and it's so this whole kind of cycle that's kind of going through me, in these really intense waves about my relationship with God. And then, then the enemy comes in with, question your salvation and all this stuff like that. So it's a bit of a whirlwind of these kind of emotions. And I just I really just want a solid relationship with God growing through this because I know he loves me. Jesus is my savior, and so I guess fear about salvation and all these things that are, like I said, cyclical with these kind of feelings when you go through these dips in the valley and stuff like that. So I was just kind of hoping that maybe you could pray with me about just, letting God do his thing, letting him love me and just giving him more control about this and taking over everything. I hope that's making some sense.
Sure. Let's pray. Father, bless Daniel. He wants to know you more. He wants to be your servant. So Lord, open the doors before him. Give him your direction. Inspire him. Empower him by your Holy Spirit. And Father, for all of us that are listening, this would be said for all of us as well, that we would truly be kingdom seekers. And so bless him. Thank you so much for his desire to know you, know more about your word. Bless him now in Jesus' name. Amen. Daniel, stay online. We'll send you out some books, some DVDs, okay?
Thank you so much.
God bless you. Use them for evangelism. Share them with your friends. Let's go to Charles in Idaho. Hi, welcome.
Hello. Thank you for your program.
Yeah, how may we help?
I'm just wondering, I know that you profess, that you teach us that we're going to be raptured out of here any time now. So my question is, why would we, I'm looking at getting some gold and silver, but if I'm going to be raptured out of here, that seems kind of like not too good.
Well, here's the thing. The Bible says, occupy till I come. And that means we kind of, we have an eye that the Lord's going to come, but we do business as usual. And so if God is inspiring you perhaps to do something along this line, well, then you can do that. You know, I've had people say, well, I don't worry about things. I just trust God. I go, well, do you have a spare tire in your car? Well, yeah. And I go, why don't you take it out? You'll get a little better mileage. And he goes, well, I might have a blowout. I might need it. And I said, don't you trust God? When you go into a store, do you have any money in your wallet? Or do you just go in there because I'm just going to trust God to find a $20 bill laying on the floor and I'm going to buy my victuals that I need? You see, there's a balance. And unfortunately, we find the pendulum swing to where God doesn't do anything and I've got to do everything, to the other way where, well, God does everything and I don't even lock the doors of my house at night. I leave the doors wide open because I trust God. Well, no, that isn't what the Bible says. There's a balance. And true Christianity, I believe, is the balance of God's word. But today we don't find that. Today we find extremes. It isn't really thy kingdom come, thy will be done. It's my kingdom come, my will be done. I just use my magic faith words and I get whatever I want. Well, what if God's calling you to be a missionary overseas in a month? Then you don't need that stuff. You see, there's a balance, but unfortunately, again, when we do not study the entirety of God's word, we get a lopsided gospel. What you believe is how you live your life. That's why Jesus said this, we live by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. You got to have that. Your thoughts, Greg?
Yeah, I know. I completely agree with you, Charles. I believe in the imminent return of Christ, but I was always trained that I am preparing for Jesus to, I am ready for Jesus to return today, but I'm preparing for him to return tomorrow or the next day or the next day. No man knows this day or the hour, but we definitely know the signs of the times. And you know, we would never think about setting a date, but you just look at the events of the Bible bingo that's going on, you know, concerning what's declared to happen in the last days. And we're seeing those unfold right before us all the time. And Pastor Mike is constantly mentioning Luke 21, 28. You know, when you see these things begin to happen, lift up your heads for your redemption draws near. Now, with that said, I think that God has always desired us to believe that he could return at any moment. And all of those in 1 John 3, talking about those who are actually the children of God. He says, how great is the gift, you know, that he has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And knowing this, that is one of the reasons that we continually are about his business and occupying till he comes. And so when it comes to finances, you know, I commend you for wanting to think that through. But in the big picture, all that stuff, you know, that's going to burn, you know. So I'm just saying, be busy, be good stewards of the resources that God has given you. It's funny that you mentioned that. I just went and talked to my financial guy yesterday, and I said, you know, I'm tired of the market the way it is, and I'm not a financial planner, so there's the disclosure there. But I just want to be, you know, I want to make sure that I'm being a good steward of the resources that God has given me to hold for him, because it's all his money. And he is going to take care of me until the day that I see him face to face. So that's what I'm trusting him for. Pastor Mike?
Yeah, Charles, you know, we just want to be good stewards. And just as he said, I don't think having some silver, some gold is a bad thing. Certainly it's going to be, you know, people have said, well, you know, it's not a Bible verse, but, you know, it came from an old Larry Norman song years ago, piece of bread will buy a bag of gold. And people say, see, gold's not going to be worth nothing. And I said, well, that's not really a Bible verse, but the Bible does say, weep in hell, ye inhabitants of the earth, for your gold and your silver have cankered. However, I will say this. if, as an example, a piece of bread will buy a bag of gold, where do you think a bag full of paper dollars is going to get you? You know, we've all seen the complete runaway inflation of our economy. We see that a new Model T Ford, in 1927, 26, a new car sold for $325. $325 for a new car. Gold was, I think then was about $27 an ounce. It went to $32 an ounce and stayed there for a long time. Now it's right around $2,000 an ounce. But your paper dollars have devalued. If you took a sack of, if you had 1,000 silver dollars in 1964, you could go to the bank and you could get paper or silver dollars. It didn't matter. You got 1,000 silver dollars, put them under your bed. You got 1,000 paper dollars, put those under another bed. You pull them out today. Well, $1,000 in 1964 would buy you a brand new Volkswagen Bug. They were right around $1,000. Today, 1,000 silver dollars will still buy you a brand new car. They're worth about $22, $25 a silver dollar for just the circulated ones. So a silver bag of $1,000 worth of silver dollars will buy you a new car. 1,000 paper dollars won't even buy you a used car, a junk car. Paper is dangerous. Thomas Jefferson said, "I fear banks more than any invading country, for through inflation and deflation, they can collapse your economy." Now, again, we're seeing that happen right now. And so I think, Charles, to be a wise steward is good. Yeah, I do believe the Lord's coming back. I don't know whether it's going to be this year or next year or 25 years. I don't know. But I do know to occupy till he comes. And I do know that as I see something radically failing like the American dollars, or even our foreign people that we're buying oil from don't want American dollars anymore. Because, okay, we buy oil from them and they get all this money, paper American dollars, and then it's devaluating. It's about 10% a year. So for every dollar, as an example, you have, it's going to be worth 10 cents less next year at this time. That's pretty scary when you stop to think about it. Well, foreign countries don't want our dollars because we won't stop spending because we have crazy people running our country right now. Evil people running our country right now. God's not blessing it. So we need to be smart. Now, again, I don't know how gold and silver may play into the picture. Inflation gets the way it was in Germany. I read stories about where the factories would pay their workers five times a day because inflation was going up that fast. And they would literally take wheelbarrows of cash down to the store. There's stories where actually people would run into the store, come out, the cash would be dumped out, and they would steal the wheelbarrows. Cash wasn't worth anything. It's paper. And see, that's the problem. We have no gold, no silver, no gross national product to back up the American dollar. The logical, smart thing would be to stop spending. But you see, in a giveaway, vote for me, everything is free mentality. In other words, look what Biden did on the last election. Oh, I'm going to pay off everybody's student loans. Completely illegal what he was doing, using public money to benefit private individuals. Can't do that, but that's what he did. Well, here's the problem. How long do you do that before you become a third world country? Friends, we're headed that way. Again, I tell people, go into your favorite discount store, Costco or Walmart or whatever. Try to find anything made in the United States. Don't make anything here anymore. We're living on our savings. No, we're living on our credit. And one of these days, somewhere, somehow, the bank is going to say, we're not lending you any more money. And the whole thing is going to implode. And I believe that's when you're going to see the one world order, the new one world monetary system come into play. And so anyway, yeah, Charles, I understand your concern. I think it's something every one of us that really love God need to be concerned with. Now, here's where the danger comes from. And I just want to say this in closing. If we're trusting in our gold or our silver or the food in our basement or whatever, something else other than God, I believe that's where the danger is. Our faith, our trust must be in God, because the other things can fail, get stolen, become obsolescent. We just have to be wise as serpents, harmless as doves, keep your eye on the prize, and be, again, very much aware of the conditions we're in. Charles, I hope that helps.
Yes, thank you very much.
God bless you, Charles. And again, my dad always had something. He said, some of the best advice, I think, he gave me a lot of good advice, but one of the things he said, when you buy something rich people want, because rich people always have money. In other words, if you've got to sell it, they'll probably buy it. If you buy a bunch of stuff nobody wants, well, that's wasting your money. Just a thought. Charles, stay in line. And again, we got our biggest treasure is Jesus Christ. We want to keep our eyes on him, but be wise with what we have and pray. I tell people, make God the CEO of your life. Make him your chief financial officer. And before you buy anything, pray and get God's opinion on that particular thing, because you're going to find many times by prayer, God will change our heart on, oh, I've got to have this. I got to have this. I pray about it and I go, I don't even need that. So be wise with what God's given us. Charles, stay online. We'll send you out some books, some DVDs. Great to share with your friends. Great information for you as well. We are coming up on a break, everyone. We'll have more to Every Man an Answer coming up right after this. We'll be right back.
Thank you for listening to CSN Radio, where God's word is heard. Did you know your financial support is a primary reason we can broadcast over 400 stations nationwide? It's true. We are grateful for your partnership. As you know, our nation is battling over religious and civil freedoms. Here at CSN Radio, our listeners can trust us to be a solid biblical teaching foundation and share a Christian perspective on current times. The importance of reaching the masses is greater than ever. We need your support in this uncertain time of chaos and strife. We are excited to share that we plan to add more stations in 2023 and 2024. This means we will reach more of the lost, broken, and deceived. Mark 16 verse 15 quotes Jesus. He said to them, "Go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation." We need your support in funding the building of these new stations. You can go to csnradio.com/donate or call 1-800-357-4226. That's csnradio.com/donate or call us at 1-800-357-4226.
CSN is proud to offer this must-read book by Berkeley Badger, 38 Hours, The Faith of God. This book is for mature Christians and anybody who wants to discover Jesus Christ. This book answers many common questions about the Bible and the life of Christ. To order your copy of 38 Hours, The Faith of God, for a donation of $16 plus shipping and handling, go online to csnradio.com or call 1-800-546-8731.
I want to welcome you back to part two of To Every Man an Answer here on this Thursday afternoon with Greg Blanc in Rapid City, South Dakota. And if you're in the South Dakota area and Rapid City area, I'd like to invite you to church. I know Greg would love to see you, and he's been always a blessing to be here on the radio with me. And thanks, Greg, for your time and what you do there in Rapid City.
Yeah, no, I'm grateful, and I think I mentioned to you last week is that we are holding a singles conference coming up in September on the 16th. And so people from all around the country will come and spend a day being encouraged with other people that are like-minded and just realizing that that single people are part of the church too, probably 40 to 45%, maybe even higher these days. I've heard some statistics that it's over 50% of the people that are attending churches today are single and married, and they just seem like they're left out in the big picture because most sermons will target families or parenting or marriage, and either people who have been through that already or have never been married, they have a harder time relating. So we just want to spend a day pampering you and encouraging you and allowing you to be around other people that just want to serve the Lord wholeheartedly, because he's our husband, right? The Lord of hosts is his name.
Amen. Let's go back to the phones. We have John on the line, Las Vegas. Hi, welcome. John, are you there? Looking for John. I don't hear John. Well, I got a little message here. What do you... John calls back. We'll try to get to your question. Let's go to Dustin, Dallas, Texas. Hi, welcome.
Hi there. So I heard a sermon a couple days ago about how the Lord said to keep a sober mind. And I've been smoking marijuana for 16 years. Is that a sin?
Well, I'll just tell you what the Bible says. It says in 1 Peter 5:8, be sober minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, goeth about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he can devour. Resist him. Firm in your faith, knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world. If I'm stoned, I'm not going to be any use to them. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 5, be not drunk with wine or in excess, but be filled with the Spirit. Anything that alters us from who we are, I believe personally, is saying, God, you didn't make me right. Now, if it's for a medical purpose because of pain or something along that lines, maybe, you know, whatever it might be, that's different. But to just get altered, to get a buzz on, you know, it's beer 30. I got to get my buzz on. Well, all I can tell somebody is that you must not like you very much. Because if the only way you can like you, if you're in a slightly altered condition, is the only way you can accept yourself, then that tells me there's something wrong with your relationship with God. In that, the Bible says that he's given us everything we need for life and godliness, and not a bag of dope to go along with it. Now, again, where do I stand on medical marijuana? I think there are millions of medical marijuana cards that are issued by fraud. I think everybody knows that. So I don't think this comes as any big surprise. Now, there may be a few out there that really, really maybe have a need for it. They're finding now, though, that marijuana, because of its wide popular use now, is having all kinds of other medical repercussions. So I think that that's fairly well established. But I think the whole question goes back, and I think we really have to look at it. Why am I doing what I'm doing, Dustin? I really think... Why do I do this? Am I doing it because I want to feel, you know, relaxed, or I want to do this? Recreational drug use, not in the Bible. Your thoughts?
Well, Dustin, I think you're a pretty brave dude for calling in.
Amen.
And being so honest and vulnerable and transparent, because I am sure that there are a whole bunch of other listeners out there that might find themselves in a similar situation as you. So kudos to you for that. Now, let me say this, Dustin. Back in the day, I did every drug under the sun, you know, back in the day. I grew up in the late 60s and early 70s, and everything was available. So I was definitely I'm definitely an ex-pothead, so I can't throw any stones there. But as a believer, let me tell you this. When I got saved, I realized that I didn't need I didn't need anything to get me to get my motor running, get me out on the highway. I just need Jesus. I want to be intoxicated by him. There isn't necessarily a thou shalt not smoke marijuana, but we get pretty darn close with Ephesians 5, you know, I think it's around 17, 18, 19, somewhere around there, where it says that we're not to be under the influence of alcohol. We're only to be under the influence of the Holy Spirit. And so exactly what Mike was saying, I'd say another thing on for the medical marijuana thing, I'd probably take a little firmer stand and say, take a cannabinol pill, smoking pot that isn't filtered. That's just going to kill your lungs. And I bet you there's something out there with all the pharmaceuticals that are there that can probably help you. It doesn't have to just be marijuana. But back to Ephesians 5, that we're not to be drunk. We're supposed to be filled with the Spirit. So in the big picture, if it's just a recreational thing, then I would say it is a sin, because that was your question. And so I'll come right out and say it. And let me explain why. Because the Bible talks about pharmakia, and pharmakia is where we get our, it's a Greek word where we get our English word pharmaceuticals. And the purpose of many drugs to pagans were found in their idolatry practices, and they would, while they were praising their false gods, they would be taking all kinds of drugs. And I would presume marijuana probably got slipped in there as well. And they did that as a ritual, as unto their false god. So let me encourage you, Dustin, God doesn't, you don't need to smoke pot to find whatever you're looking for, because there's no high, Pastor Mike, there is no high like the Most High God. So maybe we can pray for you. Well, let me, Dustin, is it okay to ask, will you quit? If you knew it was a sin, would you quit?
Well, see, that's the thing. Ever since I heard it a couple days ago on that sermon, I've smoked it twice. And both times that I smoked it, it didn't feel right. I didn't like it.
Praise the Lord. I think that you're just being sensitive to the Holy Spirit. Keep going.
Yeah, I felt like that I shouldn't do it anymore. See, I bought an ounce a couple weeks ago, and I got like 23 grams left out of it.
Yeah, flush it, buddy.
I plan on making it last a while. And so, but ever since that sermon, I haven't been able to. It hasn't felt right. I don't know. Doesn't feel good anymore.
Tell you something, Dustin. That's the way my dad was. When he got saved, my dad would smoke anything it'd burn, he said. That's his exact words. And he said, when I got saved, he says, I just lost all desire to do it. He said, he just stopped drinking. And I remember when I was a little boy, I used to go and pull the little plastic ends off the cigars that he would smoke out in the car. He'd keep them in the glove box, and I'd go out there. I was probably 3 or 4, something like that. And I'd go out there and open the glove box, and I'd pull those off because I like to chew on the plastic. Weird things we did when we were kids. But anyway, he'd get mad at me for pulling those off his cigars. And when he got saved, he didn't smoke anymore. And he said, I didn't have to fight it. He says, it just didn't feel right anymore, and I stopped. And I just go, wow, that is so awesome how God just takes those desires away. Now, some people have to fight with certain things, but sometimes God just divinely delivers. And if he has delivered you, Dustin, don't go back and he's just set you free, and take the freedom and run. Don't go back, you know? Hope that helps.
Now I'm torn on what to do with it. Do I give it away? Do I throw it away? Because clearly it'd be wrong to give it away.
Yeah.
Flush it. Just flush it.
Yeah, you don't need it. And, I just... I just really think that, you know, again, I always ask people, why do you do what you do? And again, you'll find people who drink, get loaded, you know, got to have their afternoon bong, whatever it might be. They have to alter themselves to like themselves. And this to me is a real concern because God made you good. And I don't have to turn to some external thing to make me feel good. All I need is just him. And again, he's given us everything we need for life and godliness. And so, Dustin, yeah, I would move it along. You don't need it. God has delivered you, and enjoy your new freedom in Christ and the money you're going to save. That's right. So I hope that helps, Dustin.
And I want to say thank you for answering so many of my questions. I know I call a lot, but I've got a mountain of them. Well, I wish I could talk to you all day, but hey, I'm going to save time for other people.
Dustin, keep calling. I don't mind at all. I don't think anybody else minds because I think you're asking questions that are so relevant to everybody else. I mean, yeah, we all learn. I learn when I listen, you know, on this program, when I understand what people go through and their heartache and all these things, man, I go, God, you know, and man, it changes my prayer life. It changes all these things because I realize that, man, these are my brothers and sisters and they're hurting and I'm hurting sometimes and we're all in this together. And so I really appreciate your honesty, Dustin. And I believe other people right now, as we're speaking, are being delivered from drugs and alcohol as well. And if you're listening to this and you're saying, boy, I wish that was me, it is you. Just stop. If you do not buy it, you cannot smoke it. If you do not buy it, you cannot drink it. Step out in faith, trust God, and watch the miracles happen. That's the way our God works. Stay in line, Dustin. I'll send you out some books, some DVDs, okay?
Thank you.
God bless you. And I'll send you the movie Jesus. Watch that. It's all based on the book of Luke. I think you'll really enjoy it. Let's go to John, Pendleton, Oregon. Hi and welcome.
Yes. I've been calling you quite a bit. But here about a year ago, I purchased a Geneva Bible that predates King James.
Yeah, by 51 years.
What do you think of that?
51 years, it predates it. It was based on the Textus Receptus, same as the King James. Very, very good, accurate Bible. Not a lot different than the King James, but very good. The King James was more popularized. It was where Bibles were basically banned from private ownership. King James made them available for everybody. And so that was a wonderful thing that was done. But the Geneva Bible was used by all the earlier, all of them. That's what they used. And it's about 51 years earlier than the King James, but a very good, very accurate Bible. Your thoughts, Greg?
Yeah, if my church history serves me right, that was it was published. The reason it's called the Geneva Bible because it was printed initially in Geneva. It was during the time when the Queen of England, Mary, also known as Bloody Mary, because she was persecuting. She's persecuting Protestants for their faith. She was killing them. So a lot of them left and went to Switzerland, went to Scotland. You know, where they escaped Scotland and went to areas that were a little more free, like Switzerland was at the time. And it was first printed there. And I think as Mike just said, I think John Calvin used that Bible, mm-hmm. and John Fox, a lot of these early guys, a lot of them who were actually martyred for their faith, just so that we could have these Bibles in our hands now. So never take it for granted. And like Mike said, it's a fine translation, great translation. I know I know that there are people at our church that have Geneva Study Bibles that they haul. They're big and they're thick and they haul them to church. So well done on that, right?
Yeah, I think the King James is still better. than the Geneva Bible. There were some things that influenced the Geneva Bible. In other words, up to 1600, it included the Apocrypha. And if you read the Apocrypha, this is a time of that 400 years of silence between the book of Malachi in the Old Testament and the book of Matthew in the New Testament, 400 years of silence. And there were some books written in there, the Maccabean period. And this was called the Apocrypha. But if you really read those books, you can see they're not inspired by the Holy Spirit. And that's why they were rejected by almost everyone. And this is where a lot of the crazy doctrines of the Catholic Church come from. But I mean, how to get rid of a demon. I mean, just weird stuff that's in it. Now, some is historical, like the Maccabean books. They're a little bit of history there. Not inspired, but you know, interesting. But some of these other books are really goofy. And so this is why they were, that's why they were omitted as scripture. So hope that helps.
It does help. And I just wanted to add one thing. The pilgrims that came over from England, they were persecuted by King James because he forced them to read the King James Bible, and they said, no, we're going to come over and we're going to carry our Geneva Bibles over. King James was not a nice guy.
Well, the problem is, and again, this is where there's a lot of interesting things written. If you go, as an example, to Chick Publications, there's a good story on the Geneva Bible, What's Wrong With It. That's just the title. And you can look at it yourself, and people can make up, you know, their own minds on that. I feel that probably one of the worst things about the Geneva Bible was it included the Apocrypha, which, again, by simply reading it, again, remember, Jesus never quoted from the Apocrypha. The early church fathers never canonized it in 300 AD plus. These were added in by the Catholic Church. Any last thoughts, Greg?
Nope. I think you handled it just fine. Sounds great.
Yeah, you might, anybody wants to check that out, you can just check it out. The Geneva Bible, What's Wrong With It, Chick Publications. Kind of an interesting read. I think you'll be blessed by that. Hope that helps. Stay online. If you like, send you out some books, some DVDs, John, okay?
Okay, I just want to say one last thing. King James did persecute the people coming over. He did severely.
Well, that part of my history is not there, but I am grateful for what King James did do, and that was to make the Bible not a crime to have, and to allow people to have it. So that's on the good side. So John, hope that helps. Stay in line. We'll get you out some books, some DVDs. I think you'll enjoy. Great for evangelism. Sorry we messed up earlier on that call, but glad we got it straightened out, got to talk to you. Let's go to Chuck, Oregon. Hi, welcome.
Hello, I enjoy your program's my highlight of the day, one of my highlights of the day, and I thank you. By the way, as far as inflation goes, you know, a year or two ago when I'd go to the movie theater, I would cringe at the thought of buying $7 popcorn. And I went to see The Sound of Freedom a couple days ago, and I didn't think $7 was so bad of a price anymore, so there's a...
Yeah. Well, you know, now it's $10, right? So
no, it's still $7, but that seems like a pretty good price now.
It's just great. Well, so what's so weird is you'll go into the store to buy something, and let's say it's $53, and you go back a week later to buy it, now it's $59, and you go in a week. Yeah, I think everybody's experienced this, and certainly at the groceries. We're seeing crazy stuff going on there. So, no, I know, Chuck, it's signs of the time. How can we help?
I just wanted to make a couple points about predestination, and then I'd like to just hang up and listen to your response. Number one, I don't think that a lot of people that believe in sovereign predestination would call themselves Calvinists, because I think most of us don't believe that there's some people that were chosen and, I mean, limited atonement, I guess is the word. Never read Calvin, so I'm not quite sure about that. But anyway, I don't believe that. I believe that everybody was, Christ died for everybody, and I don't think we're really going to understand that until Judgment Day. This 400-year-old argument between these two viewpoints has been going on, because each side seems to have very good points, and one of the strong points that predestination believers, sovereign predestination believers, I don't know what the word you would want to use, but anyway, those who believe in that God didn't look down through the corridors of time and saw who the goodies were and who the baddies were. And that's my point, is that I heard a preacher who preached in the free will side of things, and he said that those who God chose actually had a little spark of goodness that caused them to want to be saved. And to me, that is just totally, totally against everything the Bible teaches. And
amen.
So I think that's the one argument that predestination believers can never get an answer for. But my second point, which I didn't really clearly make, was also that everybody has a chance to choose salvation, because God looked down and saw that nobody would. And so he did make a choice. So I don't think anybody's predestinated to hell. I think it's that nobody wants salvation.
Well, people, it's not within man to live righteously, the Bible says. But the Bible also says God has given to every man a measure of faith. My question is what have we done with that? Jesus basically kind of said that when one he gave one talent, one he gave five, one he gave 10. Everybody has something. What did you do with what you had? For God so loved the world. He called everybody. Now, again, as we talked yesterday, I think when the caller mentioned, well, it's not that you chose me, I chose you, is horribly taken out of context when you read that he was speaking to his disciples, not to everybody. I use the illustration of Matthew sitting at the receipt of customs going into the city. Jesus just looked at him and said, follow me. He didn't give him a 20-page discourse. He didn't tell him about his great retirement plan or a 401k. He just looked at Matthew Levi and said, follow me. And probably Matthew Levi had heard about Jesus, and here was his opportunity. Maybe he was just unhappy in his life because of being a tax collector, being a person that wasn't really liked, maybe just the mundane day-to-day, day-in, day-out, and Jesus comes along and says, follow me. It says he dropped what he had and joined Jesus. I look at that. He didn't give him a two-week notice. He just dropped what he had and followed Jesus. It's not that you called me or chose me, I chose you. The context is everything. He's talking to his disciples. Your thoughts?
Yeah, Chuck, I was trying to read between the lines in what you were saying there, and I think the first thing that Pastor Mike and I would always say is that, you know, when it comes to Calvinism, you know, we're not anti-Calvinist, we're just pro-Bible. And the preponderance of the scriptural support does not support what Calvinism teaches. So when I was hearing you describe that you're kind of a Calvinist, but you don't believe in what Calvinism teaches, I wouldn't think that you would consider yourself a Calvinist, because I think that you realize that you can basically go through TULIP to explain what Calvinism teaches. And Calvinism teaches T for total depravity, unconditional election, limited atonement, irresistible grace, and perseverance of the saints. And three of those five are unbiblical. Unconditional election, limited atonement, and irresistible grace. I hear the music, Mike.
We're out of time. And, well, you know, check. You can call back tomorrow. Martin, Eric, Carol, Bob, please call us back. We'll put you on first thing. No waiting. Thanks so much, Greg, for being on. God bless y'all. Good night.
To find out more about this ministry or to receive a copy of today's program, please call 1-800-357-4226 or write us to Every Man an Answer, P.O. Box 391, Twin Falls, Idaho, 83303. That toll-free number is 1-800-357-4226. Subscribe to the free podcast on iTunes by searching for To Every Man an Answer in the iTunes store or visit us online at csnradio.com/TEMA. To Every Man an Answer is a production of CSN International, the Christian Satellite Network. The opinions expressed by our guests may or may not be those of CSN International or of this station.